Well, hello there, and welcome to the Pastoral Thoughts Podcast. This is your host, Jack Young, and very excited to have with us today on the podcast, Dr. Chuck Harding. And he's no stranger to our church. He's been coming to our church for, I think, over 10 years. People here, he's a hero. They admire him. And unfortunately, he was supposed to be in our services this past Sunday, but had to cancel due to COVID regulations. And he's been gracious and kind enough to answer some of the folks' questions from Lighthouse Bible Baptist Church that have been submitted to him. And of course, we are living in perilous times. And it's nice to have somebody like Dr. Chuck Harding, who's just been up in Washington, D.C. for decades now. For the last 15 years, he has been instrumental in connecting churches with the people on the Capitol, has started several different God and Country outreaches and ministries. And I've known him since I was a senior in high school. When we took our senior trip, flew from Oklahoma City to Washington, D.C., Dr. Chuck Harding was our liaison up there at the Capitol, and that was my first introduction to him. And so it's a pleasure to have him on today. Welcome, Brother Harding.
Thank you, Pastor Young. And just so that no one jumps to conclusions, we are self-quarantining. My wife and I are self-quarantining. And the reason why is because we're at a church that had a big outbreak, and we're fine, just so that everyone will understand. But the only responsible thing to do in that situation is, of course, to self-quarantine.
Yes. Hey, we're here in the state of New York, and I think there's about 33 different states that are supposed to self-quarantine if you travel in to the state. And
yeah,
your area is one of those areas. So,
is it really?
So we were hoping when you came, we would have to keep you for 2 weeks before you could go anywhere, but it didn't work out that way. Let me submit the first question. We had a lady. We were supposed to go to Washington, D.C. as a church. I think we had about 15 people signed up for this trip. We're going to go down there, spend time with you, Brother Harding, and we're going to go to we just had an exciting lineup. And because of COVID restrictions, we had to cancel the trip. And we sent one of our dear ladies on a wild goose chase. She didn't get the memo that the trip was canceled. She ended up down in Washington, D.C., and Brother Harding and his wife were gracious enough to take her out for a solid day. They went to Annapolis, had a great time. And so I'm not going to say her name because it's on the podcast, but Brother Harding knows who this is. She wanted to know how your puppy dog's doing.
Oh, yeah. Zoe's doing great. Zoe is a doodle bug, always funny, always busy. She's a Lakeland Terrier, so she's constantly, you know, with her nose to the ground, and great little friend. And she's doing excellent.
So. She just came out of the doggy hospital or something when she was down there. So
she had an abscess tooth.
Well,
we got to take care of that. But she's doing great.
Okay, hey, we got that one covered. The nation is going to be.
Zoe is okay.
And so a lot of things are going on right now in our country, of course, and people have questions about the coronavirus. And in particular, is the coronavirus being politicized?
Yes, definitely. When you look at the types of situations we've had with other flu viruses in the past, it's definitely politicized. The news media has sensationalized it. The left wing has weaponized it. And we need to biblicize it. We need to look at it from a biblical standpoint and understand that, yes, we are going to get hit every once in a while, but I think we responded because, of course, each flu strain is always unknown. Mm-hmm. That means another flu strain comes in. You don't know what it's from, whatever the case may be. In my opinion, I think this one was weaponized in the Wuhan library, Wuhan laboratory, excuse me. And that's just my opinion. People have the right to disagree with me, but I have some very, I think, credible information about that very thing. And so in any case, we just need to continue to go forward and not be so afraid. Mm-hmm. I've never seen our culture so fearful in my entire life on so many different levels.
Amen. Right.
And, you know, the fear of man brings a snare.
Mm-hmm.
And then God says in another area of his word, he doesn't bring us the spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and a sound mind. And so to whatever extent you're afraid of man and fearful to that same extent, you're diminished in your love and your power and your sound mind. So people aren't even thinking right about this. And so that's my take on that.
And what would you say the biblical view, the biblical perspective is on pestilence or on the coronavirus?
Well, when you look at it from like other strains of flu, we lose a huge amount of, you know, and look, one life is never, it's awful to lose one life to the flu, but we've lost much larger amounts of people, other flu strains than we have to this one.
Amen.
So this is not, you know, this is not the quote unquote pandemic that everyone's saying that it is.
Right.
To that extent. Yes, it is a pandemic, but it's not earth shattering. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
There have been times where in our history and world history, other flu viruses have hit us much, much worse. Swine flu, for instance. And that's what I think. So we have to look at it in context. Again, not to say that it's not serious. It is.
Mm-hmm.
It's serious. And we need to take each case and pray for these people and hope they get the right medical care. But I truly believe that it's been politicized, yes.
Okay. Yeah, me too. Me too. I'm right in line with you. And
yeah,
we're not here today to hear my opinion because I have several things, thoughts on that. But yeah. Praise the Lord. Okay, next thing.
Sure.
Our nation's founders right now are under attack. So these are two questions in line with that. How flawed were the founders, and is America a racist nation, or is there a systemic racism just like in the fabric of our nation?
Well, let me first of all say there's no such thing as systemic racism. I mean, that's being said by many, many intelligent black people. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
It's just not a situation that is happening here. And when you look at our nation, you think about this. You think about the fact that when we started, our founding fathers, yes, some of them were slave owners, and I get that. And that was wrong. And our nation were men stealers, as the Bible says.
Mm-hmm.
Should have never been men stealers. Difference, and actually there's even a difference between the slavery of the Old Testament. The Old Testament slavery, someone would actually put themselves into a slavery type of situation simply for survival in those days.
Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of an indentured type of servitude. And then every the year of the Jubilee, everyone would be set free. And then some didn't want to be set free because they loved their master. It was more of a working relationship.
Mm-hmm.
But then the Bible also talks about men stealers, and that's who certain states in our nation were. Now, when they signed the Declaration of Independence, it was stipulated that they had so many years to get this taken care of. Well, that didn't happen. And may I say, although we are very egregious, and the population, the point of any percentage of our population being enslaved was just sinful, and we corrected that.
Right.
And we corrected that with over 600,000 lives.
Right.
And we corrected that by people in the highest ranks working tirelessly for years to include John Quincy Adams, that hated slavery, and that was the only president, went from the presidency to the House of Representatives, became a district representative to try to legislate slavery away. And other people like Seward, who was in Lincoln's cabinet, that was part of the Underground Railroad, that knew it was wrong. And so, you know, but to cancel culture and to forget that, look, we weren't always perfect, but when you look at the rest of the world, percentage-wise, America is minuscule as far as, quote-unquote, being, you know, a slavish nation. We were for a time, and we corrected it. Mm-hmm. We should not forget our history and realize that the people that paid that ultimate price paid that price so that men could be free.
And isn't it true? I was going to say, according to the times, if we judge those men according to the time, they were actually ahead of their time on the ideals towards slavery, because every nation on earth had slavery, from my understanding.
Yes, every nation did.
And so you have some founders like Benjamin Franklin, who had abolitionist groups that he supported, and they had ideals to do away with slavery. They're actually ahead of the curve as far as with slavery. I know there was a few nations that beat us in abolition, but eventually we rectified the situation 7 decades later with the Civil War. And like you said, 600,000 Americans died to correct that sin of slavery. Yeah.
And that's more people than we've ever lost in every war we've ever fought in, from the beginning of our nation to the present day.
Do you have any ideas as far as, obviously there is wounds in the black culture and the black mind regarding slavery. And so if I was, you know, if we were to be honest, you know, if my, like if you live in Birmingham, Alabama, as a black person, your grandfather didn't have as much of a chance to, or upward mobility, as my grandfather did up here in upstate New York.
Right.
How do you have any ideas as far as how to rectify this divide or heal this situation?
Well, I think now, as far as geographically concerned, we're leveling off as far as that goes, because even after abolitionists and the freedom to our population entirety, there was still a prejudice, you know. And now I think that is when, and I travel all over the United States, and I see that, I see that that's leveling now, that prejudging a entire group of people by the actions of a few is beginning to now falter and fail. And the danger is, though, there's always a danger to judge the actions of a whole group of people by the actions of a few. And that's something that you can apply to what's going on today.
Sure.
In a reverse manner.
So there are dirty cops, but they're few. There are dirty preachers too. They're dirty pastors as well. And I don't want to get lumped in together with them, but we can take a sliver of a certain segment. And of course there's always going to be racists. That's just part of fallen sinful man.
It is.
And hopefully they would be on the margins of society.
Right.
Yeah.
But see, a lot of people don't understand, you know, our history either. George Washington, one of his closest confidants was a black man. Mm-hmm. You see him at the front of the boat crossing the Delaware. He's depicted there. He was with George Washington throughout the entire war. He was his closest confidant, that man. And the three men that rode off in different directions to warn the colonists. One of those men was a black man.
Mm-hmm.
Went with Cheswell, rode north to Boston. Some of the most popular preachers of the day back in those days were black men. Were had a huge amount of congregations of all color come to hear them speak. And so and those were men that were preaching with passion and preaching independence. And you see, a lot of times we just don't understand our history.
Yes,
we
sir.
Need to know. If we are going to start tearing down statues, why would you tear down a statue of an abolitionist? Huh. Why would you tear down a statue of a man that was, you know, working for decades to eradicate slavery in America? I'll tell you why, because a lot of times it's not who they are, it's just a statue. And
right.
they're trying to cancel the culture, and that is a cancer.
Yes. And right now, we somewhat have a cultural perfect storm because we have a coronavirus, and then we had this death of George Floyd. And I believe if you had no quarantine, you would have no riots in the size that we've had, because people, the kids are not going to school together. They're not going to ball games. Cities are not coming out and cheering for the home team.
You're right.
And so they're at home and the angst. And people, you can be angry at someone you're a distance away from. But when you intermingle together, you realize that they're human just like me, and you can get along as a society. And so I see this also with the shutdown of the schools and the shutdown of the ball games as they're trying to upend and overturn just America and the fabric. I mean, baseball and apple pie are under attack, you know.
Yeah, and I agree, and I don't think it's by accident.
Right, and I think it's an opportunity just to uproot the normalcy of the culture so they can redefine it and reshape this nation into, unfortunately, a socialist, Marxist country. And
exactly right.
That would be the
plot. I would
plot.
Agree with you 100%.
Yes.
And it is a design.
And even with you know, even with the kids in schools, we just got news today that our kids are only going to be going to half of the schooling, half days. And so I said, well, that's good news. We only have to pay half the school taxes then, apparently. But I mean, even the school system and just the normalcy of society is just being uprooted and upended. When you only have a 99.98% chance of dying of coronavirus, your kid is 17 times more likely to die of the flu than they are of coronavirus. And, you know, we're canceling school in the fall.
Yeah.
It's interesting times.
It's crazy. And again, it's a continuation of the dumbing down of America.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. You know? Yes, sir. Hey, well, I got an easier one for you. And you've been answering this question for years and years. So this one should be, I'm throwing you a softball, okay? So why should Christians be involved in politics, and how can they be involved in politics, and how can pastors help their churches and help save the nation?
Well, first of all, Christians must be involved in politics. Because if it wasn't for Christians, we wouldn't have the body politic of America. I mean, the reason why America is through and by the Judeo-Christian ethic. That's why. I mean, all of our documents, our Constitution of the United States, 28 biblical principles in the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, filled with references to God, where they stood, 56 men out of the humdrum of humanity, while the rest of the world was under monarchies and believed in the divine right of kings, said to the whole world that they were going to mutually pledge to each other their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor. But before they said that, they said with firm reliance upon the protection of divine providence, we will pledge to each other, mutually pledge. And these were the multi-billionaires of yesteryear.
Right.
And they were willing to give it all, ancestral wealth, going back hundreds of years, and give it all for a slim chance of going up against the greatest military in the world. And when you think about the odds, they were really minuscule by man's thinking. And these men, notable, intelligent, cultured, American royalty, actually the gentry class, many of them, being willing to do this was amazing. Now why? And how many other times has that happened in American or history period, excuse me, where 56 men that could have led lives of leisure and complete luxury chose liberty instead? You know how many times in history that's ever happened?
Yes, once, never. Yeah, just here. Yeah.
Yeah. And the reason why is because these men were so completely influenced by preachers and by getting together with congregations and looking at the, you might say, the lay of the land in colonial America, seeing so many hundreds of thousands of people getting saved, people living at peace with one another. And men of God getting behind their pulpits and preaching these passionate messages that rebellion to tyranny is obedience to God. And also, you think about this too. It is such an amazing thing to me that when these men started preaching about this sacred fire, about this element of sacrifice, what they were doing was they were affecting young men that turned out to be the next leaders that actually stood in that room in Philadelphia and signed a document that, sure enough, was looked upon by the most of the world as treasonous. But here's the biblical take on it, why Christians need to be involved in government, because they realized from preachers, from the teaching and the preaching, if God would intercede for Israel and bring them out of the tyranny of Egypt, God could intercede for the people of America and bring them out of the tyranny of Great Britain. And so that's what they said. They said, we will have no king over us but King Jesus.
Right.
And no sovereign but Jehovah God, sovereign of men's souls. And that, to me, shows the only reason. Do you think if those men were not influenced biblically, they would have ever lifted a finger toward the effort unseat King George and make this a free nation? No way.
Right.
They were monarchists, all of them at one point. But yes, they realized the egregious things that the king was doing himself. And so because of that, these men were willing to stand with only one-third of the population. I mean, try that on for size.
Yeah, they were in the minority, and people don't realize that either.
Oh yeah,
politically, I mean, they were in the minority.
One third were true monarchists, and the last one third were fence straddlers. They didn't care. They'd sell you down the river for one thing or another. Declaration of Independence was snippets of messages from pulpits decades leading up to that document. And so Thomas Jefferson were taking all of these snippets from messages. I have a book. I have one of the most amazing books in my library that is a compilation of some of these messages where this is taken from and that's taken from. And of course, the Two Trees of God by John Locke, the Christian.
Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing to me, the Christian background of our country. So should Christians be involved in government? Yes, because had we not, we would have never had a government to begin with.
Right.
And, you know, oh, we'll just let the Lord take care of it. No, 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 no. God wants us to do our duty.
Amen.
You know, we pray and put feet to our prayers. We do our duty and leave the results to God. And that's exactly what our founders did.
That's good.
And that's why we must fight today.
We're having some problem with your phone. I don't know if something changed as far as the clarity of it. The clarity. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Is that better?
That is better. That is better.
Okay, great.
You know the statistics, but what percentage of Christians actually vote?
Well,
I've heard Chad Conley. I think it was Chad Conley. He said that I think it's like 30% or something like this.
Up to the 2016 election, in previous elections, we couldn't even get 18 to 20% of people to vote.
Okay.
And went from 18% in 2016 to 81%.
Wow. Okay.
That's why we got Donald. Yeah.
Yeah. And
then here's the bad part. 2018, 52 million didn't vote that voted in 2016.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We went back to sleep.
Sure.
In 2018.
Sure.
And that's why we have to vote. Like, I mean,
yeah.
Well,
all of us were sleeping up until March, I think, too, of this year, because we had, you know, people were making 15 to 20% in their 401k. Economy was roaring. People said there's not a chance in the world anyone's going to beat Donald Trump this fall. And then we got hit with coronavirus. And then that was the, you know, start of the landslide or started this pendulum swinging.
And I believe it all orchestrated.
Sure. Yes, absolutely. In a lab, in Wuhan, and then the catalyst of keeping people locked down, separated from one another, and the work of politics in America right now seems to be pitting one group of people against another group of people. It's not about unification. It's about division, divide and conquer. You know, a house divided against itself cannot stand. And
exactly.
That's the words of the Lord and the words of Abraham Lincoln. So what can pastors do to get their parishioners involved in the process, the political process?
First of all, they must ensure that everyone gets registered to vote immediately.
Mm-hmm.
That's the first step. Have those Sundays where they have the registration cards in the lobby. That's completely legal. And you can even hand registration cards out. You know, have people say, all right, how many are registered to vote? That's great. Those that are not registered to vote, you know, let's just say everyone that's registered to vote, stand. Okay? And when that's seated, then, is not registered to vote, and have ushers come down and give them registration cards.
Mm-hmm.
And have them fill them out right there.
Right.
Turn them in. That's the first thing. Second thing, they need to make sure that they vote biblical values.
Mm-hmm. Vote the Bible.
I am sick and tired of these people saying, well, my father was this, my father. I don't care if your father or your grandfather was this or that. People say, what are you, Brother Hardy? You Democrat? You're Republican? You're independent? I'm a Christocrat.
Mm-hmm.
I vote biblical values. It just so happens that the political party that has the closest values towards God right now is the Republican Party. So that makes me a Republican. Therefore, life.
What would be the top biblical issues? I mean, what is the make or break issues that we should be aware of?
Number one is life.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're right on the life of the unborn, you're most likely going to be right on everything else. That's number one, life. The life of the unborn, okay? And the opposing groups, Republicans, and the main left wing, they're not for life. You've seen those people dressed in white sitting on their hands while President Trump gives his State of the Union, says that he is for the life of the unborn, and they're not even standing and applauding. Mm-hmm. That's horrendous. Mm-hmm. Second thing, the traditional family, okay? And the traditional family, as goes the family, so goes the nation. And we are for the traditional family. That's biblical, mm-hmm. definitely biblical thing. Third thing is the free market system. That's the sacred law of property ownership,
right,
in America. Not socialism, because socialism strangles the people. Oh, socialism, you know, can provide food and clothing, housing, even a medical attention to a certain degree, but it will destroy your dreams.
Right.
And there's no ability to dream.
And I think Christians don't realize the principles of Proverbs are capitalist, and hard work, eating the fruit of your own labor. And the Bible talks about under your own tree, under your own vineyard, your own houses. Yep. And and the reason why God allows you to make money and to increase in goods is so you can have the Christian capitalism of benevolence, where you exactly. earn something, you can give it away. And historically, America has been the most generous nation on earth.
It has been. And the reason why is because we are Christian in our orientation. Mm-hmm. There's no accident that our motto is "In God we trust."
Amen.
In God,
amen.
We trust. There's no accident that our nation is the most powerful, most influential, wealthiest nation on earth. Mm-hmm. And the reason why is because we follow biblical principles when it comes to the free market system.
That's
and
right.
That's very, very critical. Life, liberty, okay? That is the freedom of man, the freedom to think, freedom to do. Why are we talking over smartphones today? Yes. Why do we have global positioning systems? Mm-hmm. It's because in America, the mind of man was liberated through and by the Holy Spirit mm-hmm. like never before.
Right.
And I mean, we have telecom satellites. Mm-hmm. When was the first time anyone ever thought about telecom satellites? It was here. In a science fiction book.
Yeah.
And scientists looked at the book and said, you know what? I think we could do that. And
yes.
because America has unleashed the inventiveness of man, we've illuminated the light, the whole world by electric light.
Mm-hmm.
We have introduced automobiles in mass production.
Mm-hmm.
We have given the world flight,
mm-hmm.
air conditioning,
mm-hmm.
amazing array
right.
of things. We have had more inventions in America that have completely changed the world than all other nations put together.
Right. And as Christian America, not secular America, that brought about just this revolution of invention and bringing men out of the dark ages until you have a world right now where, the amount of hunger and worldwide, the amount of, their population explosion really, I think, in the last 100 years has to do with America being able to invent all these goods to help mankind forward.
Exactly.
Yes.
And
yeah.
So, the way, go ahead.
I was going to say, JFK said, a rising tide lifts all ships. And we have had a rising tide here in this country that has benefited the whole world. That shining city on the hill that Reagan talked about.
Exactly right.
Yeah. Amen.
And, when the Christian goes to the polls to vote, they need to vote for the platform, not for the person.
Yes.
I've heard people say, well, I don't like the way Donald Trump says this or that. Look, I'm not voting for a pastor.
Right.
I'm voting for a president.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't like the way he says some things, but I sure do like what he says.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe not the way he says them, but what he says.
Right.
It's so very important. And so,
he's not our Messiah. Jesus is our Messiah. I'm not voting for.
Exactly.
Yeah, I'm not
right.
voting for Messiah. We want to lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and all honesty.
Right.
And so what party is going to give us religious freedom, stand for the unborn? What party is going to unleash the principles of the book of Proverbs on the land so we can enjoy a bounty? So, yeah, amen. I've got two other questions. Remember, these are questions that are submitted by our church here. And so I didn't come, I shouldn't get blamed for these ones. But here are some some titillating questions that, you know, they talk about in the evening news, and they will continue to talk about it all the way to the election.
Okay.
So we'll give these to Brother Harding. I'll just give you two in a row, and you can answer them however you want to answer them. So if the Dems, the Democrats, take control of the presidency in the House and the Senate, do you foresee some states seceding from the Union? And then number two is this. Do you believe there'll be voter fraud this presidential election? So those are the last two questions. So handle them how you want.
I'll take the last one first.
Okay.
There's been voter fraud every election.
Mm-hmm.
But if Christians, if the 82 million Christians show up and vote, it will not make a difference. And they're constantly fighting against voter fraud. And the voter fraud is unscrupulous, always left wing, because they're the ones that have no scruples.
Mm-hmm.
And so there will be voter fraud. But don't let that deter you. We need to stay before our God on our face and ask him to give these people that are looking for the voter fraud unearthly wisdom, help them to be in the right place at the right time, take this thing out. But more, even more than that, the Christians will vote, and it'll be such a landslide.
Mm-hmm.
Not only of Christians voting in historic numbers, but conservatives voting as well. And remember this, too, about voting. I've heard people say this, well, I'm just tired of voting for the lesser of two evils. Look, I've never seen Jesus Christ on the ballot.
That's right.
So I think we've always voted for the lesser of two evils. Mm-hmm. Well, I just want to vote my conscience. But if you want to vote your conscience, then let me ask you, are you praying for the president and the vice president, 15 cabinet members, 6 cabinet rank members, 9 Supreme Court justices, and all of your elected officials each and every day? And when I ask that to people, there's silence.
Mm-hmm.
I said, now, if you're not doing that, you are not following Scripture's exhortation to supplicate, pray, to see and give thanks for those people. And so please don't tell me your conscience wakes up every 2 to 4 years
mm-hmm.
if you're not praying for our leadership every day by name. And so
amen.
I
think it'd be a wonderful thing, and we've talked about this, and we do have prayer meetings at our church, and we do have some set aside time for we'll fast as a church. But if churches in this country would fast and pray and set aside time to meet together as a church and petition the throne of God, man, that is going to that's going to change the election. I remember, and I think that probably you remember too, Brother Harding, or you came across this same thing, is when we had Donald Trump running against Hillary Clinton. I think Christians were petrified of Hillary Clinton, and they were praying. I remember being in the supermarket, different things, and meeting people who I don't even think they were saved, that they said that they were praying for Donald Trump to get elected. And I think there was a spirit of prayer in the last presidential election. And I pray that there is one again this year.
Yes, we need to be praying and fasting. Mm-hmm. And I'm putting out the call to churches to take, well, churches are doing it different ways. Some are asking different people in their congregations to pray and fast each day, or even pray and fast during a meal. And mm-hmm. then some whole churches are praying and fasting one day a week together wow. as a church.
Wow. Amen.
And that will be powerful. Mm-hmm. If everyone, you know, like even on a Wednesday night, say, you know, Wednesday, we're going to pray and fast until the election. Mm-hmm. Unless there's a health issue, mm-hmm. you know, our church is going to be praying and fasting every Wednesday night. And our Wednesday night services will be a short Bible study, but then we're going to go to prayer. Amen. We're going to cry out to God for our nation. We've never been in a more critical state in our country's history. Never.
Right.
And, you know, if, I don't think it's going to happen. I really don't. But if the Dems would take the House and the Senate, and the presidency, there is one state in the union that can constitutionally secede.
The Republic of Texas.
Yes. Yep, the Lone Star State.
Right.
So, you know.
I see, too, like, for instance, in these sanctuary cities, they say that we're not going to enforce federal law. So could you see some of these southern states saying whatever federal mandate comes down from the president and the House, they say, you know what, we're not going to do that, and what are you going to do about yeah. it?
Nothing.
Right. So I could see that before states seceding. That's interesting.
And, but, you know, if we pray and fast, I don't think that will even be a concern.
Amen.
Because I believe what's going on right now shows over 90% of the people in America who do not want this kind of nonsense continuing. But they will, the silent majority, rise up in mm-hmm. the 2020 election mm-hmm. and we will see something happen like you wouldn't believe, because we are in the middle of a major pivot in our nation's history. Mm-hmm. We've only had very few. You can count them on two hands. We've had very few major pivots in our nation. And there's a little bit of debate as to how many there have been. We're in one of the most major pivots, and we could pivot back to our Lord in a big way. This president gets back in with the House behind him and a Senate, improving on the Senate even. I believe he will do things for this country that no one has ever seen any president do in their lifetime. Good things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Amen.
So that's what I'm counting on.
Amen.
That's what I'm praying toward. That's what I'm working for. That's what I've given my life for these last 18 years. And I mean, my wife and I moved. We relocated back to the Washington, D.C. area 8 years ago. And we still haven't unpacked.
Mm.
So that shows you how busy we've been
yes.
for our country. But the results in getting President Trump, can you imagine if Hillary had gotten in?
Mm-mm.
What state of affairs? I mean, we would already be gone.
And a lot of people do not remember, because we have short-term memory.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't remember how dire the United States was in 2015.
Yeah.
And economically and our reputation around the world. And then just, our GDP was going down, you know. And 4 years, our current president, despite his flaws and all his foibles and his idiosyncrasies, his narcissism, you know, you name it, has implemented certain biblical principles that have allowed our country to flourish. And, he has very, very many enemies. And so, we must pray. Spiritual battle.
Oh, yeah.
Last question I have for you. This is mine.
Okay.
It's easy for us to get drawn into the drama of Washington, and of course with the 24-hour news cycle and the really the ultimate fear mongering, you know, you see every night on the nightly news, you got these guys and gals sitting behind the desk and they're like Chicken Little, man, the sky is falling every night, the world's coming apart. And I see a lot of Christians getting sucked into that, and there is a balance because we want to be involved in the system. We want to be involved in politics, but to talk night and day about, did you see the latest, what Nancy Pelosi did or this or that? And I'm thinking, you know, what can we do about it besides vote, call our elected officials, pray, whatever. But I see Christians a lot of times being drawn into politics, and I think in a negative way or in a spirit of fear. Is there any way to balance these things out?
Definitely. That is by opening up the good news.
Amen.
You know, the news is where they begin with good evening and then proceed to tell you why it's not. Okay?
Right.
But the good news is God's word. Mm-hmm. And so we need to understand things aren't going to wax worse and worse. It shouldn't surprise us. And You have no idea how many phone calls I field of people that are in that exact category.
Right.
And they're calling me, and I know what's happened. They just got through watching the news. Mm-hmm. And what I do is I bring them to a biblical balance again. You know, Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3 that in the last days, perilous times shall come. But then he gave him seven things to continue in, to do. Mm-hmm. Number one is doctrine. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's our belief system. Okay? That is staying, resting, continuing in the foundation of being a Christian. That's God's word. Okay? That's why our nation has no anchor. Because our nation, by and large, has given up God's word, but we must anchor ourselves in it continually. Okay, so we've got to continue it in doctrine. Secondly, in our manner of life, you know, we've got to continue going forward and not just thinking of ourselves, because that's exactly when we get fearful, we're thinking of ourselves. It's like in a self-preservation mode.
Sure.
Okay. But when you go beyond that and you start thinking of those people around you, it calms your fears and you realize, wait, I'm not in this thing just to survive it. I'm going to live through it. And I think of Gary Bikert's little letter to his men of the Medal of Honor Society, where this first started. And he was in that jungle camp in the highlands of Vietnam and asked that young Montagnard boy to teach him how to survive in the jungle. And the little boy smiled and said, I don't want to teach you how to survive. I want you to know how to live.
Huh.
Jungle provides us life. He went, wow.
Yeah.
You know what? I was looking at it all wrong. And for the next year in the jungle, he taught me how to live.
Wow.
In the midst of something that I had been afraid of. He taught me how to look beyond what was the unknown, find things that could give me life by knowing what my purpose was and by realizing that I was a part of his tribe. We are part of a tribe.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And it's the tribe of Issachar.
Mm-hmm.
Those men that have an understanding of the times, and because they have an understanding of the times, taking God's word and applying it to God's world, then we can continue to do our purpose, and that's to reach out to others. People kind of get concerned about what's going on. Let them go soul winning.
That's right.
Reach out to someone that's lost, you know?
And that gets you out of yourself.
Out of yourself. Oh,
yeah.
Nothing like it.
And I tell you what, you get the Holy Spirit into somebody, and throwing them to Christ, they will change. I haven't ever persuaded someone intellectually to change their vote. I've never been successful at doing that.
No.
But I have done it by just leading someone to Christ and to have Jesus living inside of them, and then they understand biblical value from that. So, amen. That is great advice. Tell us about, before going, tell us about the prayer call. It's so awesome. You mentioned Gary Biker. I was on the prayer call that as a month or so ago. You had Woody Williams, Medal of Honor recipient from World War II. I think he's about 98 now.
I think he's 97.
You know what? You're right. Yeah. He's 1 year younger than my grandmother. I remember that now. 97 years old. Medal of Honor recipient, Woody Williams. And then you had on Gary Biker, Medal of Honor recipient from Vietnam. And he's a Rochester native. He lives on the other side of the town here and loves the Lord. And these men were on the prayer call that one night. And this was the most moving prayer call. I've missed quite a few of them. I'm blaming it on my family. 8:30 at night, the prayer call that night, that you had on a young pastor's son, I think he's about 10, who just had...
Joel McConkey.
Okay, yeah. So he had just had his bone cancer, his surgery, and those two Medal of Honor recipients, two national treasures, two men that are esteemed Americans, give that young man a charge. And then they both prayed, and it was so powerful. That was a moving, moving prayer call. But you've had great prayer calls. Can you give us some information about that and how people can get on the prayer call?
Sure. Sure, yes. And to pray in one accord is a powerful, powerful thing. It's something that we must do for our country. Every Tuesday night, 8:30 p.m. Eastern time, we get together, hundreds call in from all over the United States, Alaska, Hawaii, and the number is 339-207-6363. This last Tuesday, we had the highest ranking combat veteran ever to be elected to the United States Congress, 3-star general, Jack Bergman, who is United States Congressman for District 1 of Michigan. An amazing Christian, tremendous man. And so he was with us this last week. And, of course, John Jenkins and his communications director, James Hogue, Jack Bergman's communications director. James Hogue, and his son has gone through some major surgeries, just a little boy. And so we're praying for him and praying for many others. And he gave a very refreshing, very unique outlook, stirring prayers, powerful. If our country needs anything right now, our country needs prayer, fasting and prayer. And when hundreds of people from all of the United States, I mean, we have Washington State calling in. We have Florida calling in. We have Maine. We have Alaska. We have Hawaii. We have Tennessee, Texas. It's, you know, from all over the United States, people are calling in. And everyone's muted except for the pastor that I have pray and then our keynote speaker. Mm-hmm. And so I welcome everyone to come on 339-207-6363. And you will enjoy the National Prayer Call for America. It's what we need. It's what our nation needs.
Amen. It is outstanding. It's wonderful. It takes only about 25, 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's it. Yeah.
On Tuesday nights, it's wonderful. And
thank you.
Where can the folks find you at? I know you got a website. What's that website? I'll put the number, and I'm going to put your website in the show notes, too, so people can. Where can they find you at?
Yeah, it's Mission to America. .us missiontoamerica.us and that's our website. And then I'm on Twitter as well, but you can look everything up through our website, missiontoamerica.us.
Amen. Hey, thank you so much for being on the show today, Brother Harding. And just on behalf of the people here at Lighthouse Bible Baptist Church, we love you very, very much. And we're happy to have you there in D.C. on our behalf. And thanks again. Now, for the folks listening, make sure that you subscribe to the podcast. We had a great conversation last week with missionary to Germany, mechanic to missionary, elevator mechanic to missionary, Joel Bierman to Germany. And next week, we're going to have on a special guest. We're going to be talking about the life and ministry of D.L. Moody. And so make sure you subscribe. You can also find more information out at pastorjack.org. And thank you. God bless each and every one of you. And look forward to hearing back from you and reaching out to you. And been a wonderful day today, Brother Harding. God bless you.